connecting with the hypotenuse. You can imagine it. So is it real or not? So that's a toughie, isn't it? What do you mean by real, right? Consciousness doesn't, you can't experience taking a measurement of consciousness. It doesn't extend into space. So consciousness, like the Pythagorean theorem, is not an extended thing. It's not an example of stuff. Like, you can't make a chair out of it. You can't eat it. You can't draw on it or anything like that. You can't weigh it. Sixth, the question of where did the universe come from is the question of cosmogony. That is correct. You are correct. It is not cosmology, because as question 7 gives you the opportunity to demonstrate, cosmology is the question of what the universe is really like. Logi, a word about the discussion or the study of, yes. It's all of the sort of language that can be assembled that's factional about that. Okay. Number 8. According to Genesis, in the Hebrew Bible, the word is identical with God. Negative. Number 9. According to the ancient Hindus, God and the world are definitely distinct. They are not the same thing. No, the ancient Hindus thought that this whole world and everything in it is God, synonymous with God. In fact, to the ancient Hindus, in trying to figure out why the heck all of it, anything, why? Because God eternally pre-existed at one point decided to play. So if there's nothing that's been created, all there is just God. There's no planet, there's no people, there's no Safeway, there's no car tires, there's no kangaroos, there's no boogers, there's no nothing. So then God decided to play and said, I'm going to trick myself for my amusement. I'm going to manifest myself as all of those things. And each little bit of it, I'm going to, like, before I jump into it, I'm going to set it up so that once I get in it, I won't know it's me. That sounds like kind of a fun game, doesn't it? I mean, think about movies like Total Recall. Movies where you have, I won't quote the protagonist in what he called those kind of movies, but it was some mind blank, something that goofs with your mind. And well, I'll just leave that to your imagination, because we're straddled with Victorian nonsense about off-limit taboo obscenity terms. So I won't grace you with that. You can use your imagination, which people always do anyway. It seems like in decent company, as long as you put a bunch of like the shift key and touch the numbers, all this ampersands and pound symbols and everything, then you can just leave a couple of letters out and then you can say it.
What was number 5 again?
Number 5, according to Solomon, whether or not we agree that mind and body are two different substances, basic kinds of stuff, the qualities of consciousness are nevertheless very different from the qualities of the body, specifically the qualities of the brain. And that's true. That's true. Thanks. I went right over 5 and didn't get it. It wouldn't be again, though. It would be, hey, stupid, how come you didn't tell me number 5? You just went right over. That would be more accurate. So I appreciate your euphemistic gift. It was a really diplomatic thing. Could you give me number 5 again? I know that it's going to be. You didn't really forget it. So imagine that you wanted to amuse yourself by setting up a VR situation so real, a virtual reality setup so real that you wouldn't be able to tell that it was set up that way. Imagine that, say 10 years from now, there's a video game that's so indistinguishable you can't know. And it's interfaced with the nervous system. It's not looking at a screen. It's actually interfaced with the nervous system. The only way out of it is for somebody else to come and shut it off. And you might have programmed it to shut off at a certain time, too. That might be, you know, it's like, I'm going to do this for an hour, but when I'm in there, it won't even let me have the memory that I'm in there. It will make me think this is my reality. And all the memories in my backstory are actually in my memory. And we can probably do that very soon. That's probably actually something we could do. So that's exactly what the Hindus pictured that God was doing. He was setting it up like that for ultimate play. Ultimate role-play gaming is what they say was happening. And that fits very incredibly with what a lot of physicists are saying today, that it's very, very difficult to avoid concluding that we are in a virtual reality game. So what we think of as being hey, we're right here, right now. I'm not dreaming. I'm not LSD or anything. We're all right here having this experience. That this is actually, we're characters in VR. And I gave you some pretty good evidence for that when I demonstrated to you that matter itself, when we get right down to it, is not actually made up of what we think of as matter. It's just made up of mathematical relationships. It factually is. I'm not playing with you now. It is made up just of mathematical relationships. And since all matter is made up of what matter does, and matter is just what it does, and matter is nothing more than matter in motion or matter in relationship. No, it doesn't make sense. It has to have some other explanation. It doesn't make the kind of sense that things have to make to be plausible in our four-dimensional reality, period. So there is something going on that we can't get at. It's not ours to have. Very much like we talked about stick figure guy on the board. There's a book by Edwin Abbott called Flatland, Romance of Many Dimensions, the text of which is actually screened onto my tie. That is the book on my tie. Very, very small, almost too small to read letters, but it's the book. Yeah, it's the whole book. It's there somewhere. It's not very easy to read on my tie. It's better in the book. In this book, the notion is grappled with of what it would be like to be a character living in a flat world, like the dudes on the chalkboard that we draw stick figures, shapes, and all of that. And it's a novel, a little novelette about what happens when somebody like from with our number of dimensions would go in there and try to communicate with those folks and how that seems to them. And very creative. It was written by an English teacher and schoolmaster for his late middle school, early high school age guys at an all boys school, and he thought that the literature that was available for them was banal and crap, so he wanted to write something that could really get their minds around and be more enjoyable. I find the book incredibly enjoyable, and we are going to watch a movie of it. It's been made into a movie, which is it's a cartoon. Watch that. Anyway, the Hindu's notion is that when we become enlightened, when we get it, when it's like, oh yeah, duh, why couldn't I have seen that?
It's when we recognize that what has happened is us and everything else is God in costume to a masquerade. And that this whole thing is just every character and every little piece of everything is God in costume, pretending and forgetting, because God decided to forget when we started the whole thing, ready, set, go. So, anyway, number 10, one of the differences between scientific and religious accounts of the origin of the universe is that the scientific accounts seem mainly interested in how the world originated, and then religious accounts are more interested in why the universe exists. D is correct. That's that. And in terms of the fifth, now guys, this is weird, and we're skipping way ahead, because a lot of the tools that would serve us in getting through this, we'll have to kind of get the tools afterwards. It's like looking at something that's broken and going, I don't know how to fix that, and then now you know why we're trying to develop the tools. And I honestly don't know what I'd have done with this story in my 20s. I don't know. I probably would have just said, oh, that's a bunch of crap, and just rolled right along. It took a long time and a lot of journey to where, when I heard this, I said, oh, no kidding. Wow, yeah, that follows, honestly. And then I actually made the acquaintance of some of the people actually involved in doing the experiments. And I would have blocked this out by just playing the Satan card when I was a young man. I would have simply said, okay, that I don't already know. That's new to me, so that must be from the devil. Because I know that anything that's true, I already know. And so it fails the I know that test. But think of the logic of that. If all the new stuff you get, you run it through the filter of, did I already know that? No, I didn't. I didn't know anything about that. It must be crap. That's really a negative growth model. There's no growth. It's probably actually, since stuff's always falling off the back end, think of honestly whether in August you're going to remember the answer to number 5. I mean, in August, you're going to be all set with this. Even some of you that got all of these right, I mean, in August, you're going to be going, oh, yeah, I got that master. This is pretty good. Well, some of you, yes. Most people's memories don't work like that. Mine actually usually does work like that. I actually do remember stuff once I hear it. Not word for word, but conceptually. And if an event occurred, I don't go, wow, how come there's evidence of this and I don't remember anything about it. But I encounter people every day that I had common experiences with, and I remember the details of it. And I go check like the physical evidence of it, like receipts or something, and they deny in their honest heart that they had that experience. It blows me away. I have a few friends who similarly remember and just don't seem to forget events. And when you get up into the geriatric age range, a lot of our friends really don't remember diddly about being in high school. They don't just, it's all a blur. And we're getting to the point where some of them, they don't remember very much about their time at PUC, even though we were here the same years that we were. Had one guy who I worked with at public safety. I was the dude's supervisor. He was a dispatcher, and I supervised him for 2 years. And I remember really important and mind-blowing things that happened involving him. And when he came here to campus, it's been a few years ago now that he came here, when I was working in Newton Hall, he came into my office in Newton Hall, hey, how you doing? And we were reminiscing, and I said, hey, remember the time that this happened? And he said, huh? I said, yeah, when we were working at Public Safety. He said, I don't think I ever worked at Public Safety. Okay, I'm in a parallel universe. Kid you not. I try to talk to people when they come for alumni weekend here, and I say, hey, remember the time when in Wayne Judd's doctrinal studies class when you said yada yada about the well, he used this illustration and you responded to everybody that, and you said, I don't think I took any classes from Wayne Judd. I say, I was a TA. You definitely took the class. I remember your answers. I don't think I got any classes from him. I remember having some classes from so and so, but I don't have classes from him. I guarantee you, a number of you will do that and say, I honestly don't know if I had a class from Robert Kurtz. That will happen to some of you. It really will. Do you remember the name of every kid in your kindergarten class? Well, I do. I don't remember the name of your kindergarten class. So, do you remember even all of your teachers' names?
Oh, would you consider yourself having a photographic
memory? No. Like eidetic memory? I do not. It's just that I don't. You know the stuff that you can remember pretty much last week? Like, stuff that happened last week. If I ask you what happened last week, you can tell me most of it, right? Yeah, I mean, probably. Like, right now, if I say, what did you do Saturday night? I'm not asking you, but if I did, you'd be able to describe Saturday night for me, right? Pretty much. You know what you did on Sabbath. Yes. So, you don't remember all the license plates from the cars you saw. No. I don't remember that kind of stuff. But the way that you remember Saturday night, most of that, you know, like 95% of that, I just, because you won't, if I asked you, do you know what you did, say, the Saturday night, say, two Saturday nights before school started this fall? You don't, do you? This last fall quarter, you know, two Saturday nights before, you don't remember what you did. Well, for the most part, I can go back and reproduce most of that stuff, and then most of it doesn't go away. And so I can check my memory because I've never thrown away any receipts or any diaries or journals or appointment books. I've kept them. They're scanned, and I can look things up real specifically. Someone says, oh, you know, we went to yada yada, yada, and I say, no, we talked about going there. We didn't go there. We actually went so-and-so, and then we went to eat at the such-and-such, and then we stopped at Costco that day. And I can have this discussion with my kids from when they're little. And then I'll go back and look it up on Quicken or in my appointment book, and I'm right. Almost all. That was good when I was a cop. It's pretty useless most of the time, though. Except that I remember the concepts. When I get a concept in class or something, I remember.
This is meant to be a little bit funny, but does that get you in trouble with your wife because of like the fact that you know, because women are usually right? But if you're like, no, you're wrong. Like, how does that work?
Yeah. Good call. No, my forgetter is kind of broken, and it's actually not that helpful sometimes. There's like, the tape imposes itself and runs anyway. I know everybody has memories, but I'll like get a day stuck, and it'll just keep going while I'm going through this day, and it just should have been
put into the trash a long time ago. It's usually not useful. It's usually intrusive. It's really good, though, that I do remember the things that my teachers taught. I can go back and tell you what they said. I can tell you what I learned in this classroom in general psychology. I can just go through it and tell you the things that I learned in general psych in 1979. I've met people, though, that have sort of the savant thing where they actually have, like, they see pictures with numbers in them and all that stuff. I've met people like that. I've met people that are really savant. They have bizarre abilities. I don't have anything like that. And it's not like 100% either. It's just like 90 to 95% about most things. So you'll forget most things. And the fact is that my memory and your memory isn't actually what happened. It's sort of our best guess of what happened because we didn't get it right in the first place. A lot like that, yeah. It's a lot like I experienced it. So if I'm walking, like, say I'm just walking through a parking lot here, and then we get out of the parking lot and you say, did you see the license plate on that car? Well, no, probably not. It's just like the stuff that made it into, if you could have asked me a little wipe, like, the next day or whatever, yeah, it's not as perfect as somebody who would be word researching. I mean, I have friends that are my age. Because I know people that just, like, you can ask them strange things, like the two autistic identical twin sisters that you can just bring up a day and they'll tell you the weather, what they ate, what was on their favorite TV program, what they were born, every word that each other said. They're spooky strange. You can look that up on YouTube. You can see interviews with them. There was a game show on TV, and they were just in love with the talk show host. And somebody brought that out, and then that host, having already retired, I think it was Wheel of Fortune, actually. It was Alex Trebek. And so he heard about that, and he wanted to go meet them. So he went to meet them, and he checked see how well they remember. They remembered what he was wearing every day, the whole run of his whole career. And he became, they became some of his closest friends. He became like family for them and continued to visit them regularly and make sure they were okay and all that. Because they're not really that functional. They're totally like on Social Security the whole life. Yeah, it could be Jeffrey. Who was the one from Wheel of Fortune? Trebek was probably Jeffrey. Yeah. See, that's an example of the kind of data that I couldn't have told you an hour later because it wasn't material. But they would have never gotten that wrong. But I mean, some things, once I memorize some things, it deteriorates after a while and it's sort of fact-based. But I know all of you. I mean, I know all of your names. And that took me, like, just a few runs to know all of you. So, and probably you don't know everybody here. Even if I gave you the list, you might not. But I know every one of your names. And some things that I memorized, they start petering out because they're just data. I don't have anything personal with them. Like pi. I have to brush up on it. I brush up on it like the day before Pi Day every year. It reminds me of some of the new sums to be Pi Day. So I look at it again and refresh it so I can get up to like 150 or whatever places. So normally I can get
other things I have to remind myself of, like Planck's constant, and that changes. That's what screws me up with Planck's constant. It keeps changing every 4 years. The group that votes on it and averages the values from taking around the world for Planck's constant, they can't tell whether they don't know whether it's changing the constant or whether it's a matter of just pooling inaccuracies every 4 years. Yeah, PLANCK. Planck. Yeah, just depends on on your accent.
What?
Planck's constant.
Yeah, sure.
Planck's constant is the ratio of fundamental values, of elementary fundamental values. You multiply it by small integer values, like 1, 2, 3, 4, to get the difference in energy levels, for instance, that are even possible. It can be expressed in terms of the Planck second or the Planck moment, which is at absolutely the speed of light, how far does it go in a second? For instance, you can change the units around if you want, but it's like it's also energy, amount of energy over wavelength or something like that. So it represents, in terms of what units we're talking about, the granularity of our physical universe. So if you take something like this, and this is printed, it came from a press or printer or whatever, and you look at it, it looks like it's just colors. But if you use the microscope to look at it, you can see that it's actually just dots that are actually quite a ways apart with white spaces, right? Well, it turns out if you look closely enough at stuff, anything, any matter, it's actually same. It's dots of a certain size, that reality itself is just dots of a certain size that are actually a long, long ways apart compared to how big the dots are. It's like millions of times more empty space than it is dots. And then if you look closely at the dots, they're made of dots that are the same. They're just billions of times further apart than they are big. You go down far enough like that, and you get to the point where you look, and it isn't that way. It's not made up of little pieces. It's actually not made up of anything. It's actually just energy. And what's energy? Well, it isn't stuff, right? So stuff isn't made of stuff. So there's some rotten memory about the way the universe is actually put together. It appears to be some sort of a simulation. When something has not yet become a piece of stuff, and I used the example of a photon. Remember I talked about the double slit and the gold foil experiments? We can demonstrate that the human mind, when it first measures and is aware that it's been measured, when it detects and gets registered by some device that we arrange, some arrangement, some apparatus, we arrange something so that we can perceive it as an actual piece of stuff, then it no longer has the capacity to act like a wave. It can't anymore. You're broken. You locked it in. It's a little bit like if, and I don't, you know, I don't want to offend anybody, but I'm just using it as an illustration. If gender was something like that, it's like, if, say, a child was born and nobody investigated his gender. They were very careful, very modest, and never even looked. But the first time somebody looks at you know, a little naked baby, like, oh, it's a boy, then it becomes a boy. But before that, if somebody had actually, like, perceived that it had been a girl, even like in the ultrasound, then it would have not been able to become a boy. That's kind of like what photons act like. But it turns out it's actually the same, not just for waves of light. It's true of matter waves. That's something more recent to discover. But it turns out matter is like that too. It's in waves too. We have this function and this function. Each one can be described by a mathematical function. But before we measure it to be one or the other, it has both potentials. As soon as we get rid of one of those potentials, we say we collapse the alternate wave function. So, you know about radioactive stuff. If you have a Geiger counter, you're checking to make sure there's no radioactivity, and you put it next to your glow-in-the-dark watch or whatever, you know, and you start to hear it going click, 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 click. If you take a single, just one little sample of something, and it's set up so that it has this sample has just enough of it, and the half-life is just such that you're going to get an average, say, per minute of, say, 30 clicks when you put the Geiger counter next to it. If we just listen to the substance, to that controlled amount of substance, just keep it there. Every time we measure, say, 30 minutes, it's going to be, or 1 minute, it's going to be approximately 30. So that if we measured it for 100 minutes, and every minute we recorded exactly how many clicks there were from the Geiger counter, and then we averaged it, it would average 30 per minute. Did everybody follow that? It's really important about the fish, because we're on the fish now. And we're actually on the fish. So it turns out that when you think about it, radioactive decay is actually a quantum process. We don't have any idea why it's decaying like it does, and why it's, if you watch just one piece of it, it may or may not come on. It's just half-life just means in a certain amount of time, half of it will have decay, that it has the potential to decay. So if we watch just one of them, though, it may never. And it even turns out that if we do watch just one little atom, to see if it decays, it turns out that it's like the watch pot never boils. It's called the quantum Zeno effect. As long as we're looking at it, it ain't going to happen. And if you look at it enough, it's like training an animal. It gets locked in by our consciousness.
Professor, last class period, we briefly discussed the good life, so to speak.
Yes?
We didn't really go in depth, and the conclusion that we arrived at the end of class, to be honest, I was unsatisfied with our conclusion.
Me too.
And I would like to explain why, if I could give an example. You know, we arrived at the conclusion that it's all a matter of perspective. Well, you know, if you just so happen to arrive at great riches, it doesn't matter what we do with it, because it's our perspective.
That's what we arrived at?
That's essentially what we arrived at.
That isn't my position, but what I did was illustrate a potential position.
Okay.
I can illustrate the opposite.
Well,
But, I mean, who's to say? Who's it up to?
And that's the question I'd like to propose. So, for example, you know, I saw a video online. There's a guy, he's an entrepreneur named Ty Lopez, right?
Name what?
His name's Ty Lopez. And just to be clear, I'm not God or anybody. It's not my job to judge him. And it might sound like I am, but maybe I'm a little biased in my opinion. So, he's an entrepreneur and he has, of course, quite a lot of assets, right? Now, he has made a lot of YouTube videos. Every time you see a YouTube video of him, like, if you've been on YouTube, you've seen it. You know, this is my garage. And he, like, talks about all his
videos. He's clickbait. I saw that thing.
Yeah.
He's got library books in the garage.
Yeah.
I know who you mean.
He's got six, like,
yeah,
very expensive luxury cars.
I've seen that. I clicked it once and I thought,
yeah.
And then I realized, that he's trying to sell me a course.
He's got two Lamborghinis, two Rolls Royces, a Ferrari, and a Maserati, and he lives in a $1 million house.
Yes.
And this is just an example. This is, you know, a lot of people, and that's, you know.
Sure.
You know, just one example.
Is that the good life?
Well, no, that's not my question. The question is, like, where do we draw the line? Because some people would say, well, it doesn't matter. He can do whatever he wants with his money, which he can. But is it right? Where do we draw the line? Because
for what's right?
In my life experience, I mean, like, I mean, we all learn different things as we travel or as we read books, things like that. You know, I read a book last year about human trafficking. I had no idea what it was. You know, I heard Chantel say something about it when she spoke, and then I read the book. And I was appalled. I was, you know, just completely shocked. There are 51 million people who are victims of human trafficking. You know, those young girls are raped 15 to 30 times a day for, you know, the 25 cents, the price of an orange. You know, and there are organizations that help to bring them out of the brothels and, you know, build this, like, you know, entire complexes where they can get counseling for the rest of their life for free.
Yes.
Teach them how to, you know,
get that seems food, good, right?
Something like that, or, you know, children, 31 million children approximately die every year from malnutrition.
Yeah.
So, not that it's bad to have maybe a nice car or something or a nice house, but, like, where do you draw the line? Because there has to be clearly defined that's selfish, you know? Why do you need to have six, you know, $400,000 cars in your garage?
Why have a car?
Where people are being raped and you can help them.
Why have a car?
To get from point A to point B.
Do you realize how many people in this world have a car?
Yeah, I don't.
I mean, you don't have a car?
No.
Do you intend to get a car?
Yes.
Why? Go from point A to point B. But the vast, overwhelming majority of people do not have a car and never will. Does it hurt the planet to have a car? It doesn't hurt the planet to have a car?
It doesn't hurt the planet to
yeah.
have a car.
I'll help you with that.
Depends on what kind of
depends on how you define hurt. If you mean, like, screw it up, then yes. let me see your shoes. Do you realize how few people on this earth will ever have shoes in as nice as that? Proportion, I mean the percentage.
Well, you know, a certain part of the world, Asia, India, is kind of skewing.
Where do you go to school?
BC.
What does it cost a year?
Almost 40,000.
Do you have any idea what an extravagant luxury it is to obtain an education that costs that much money?
Yes,
where you draw the line, I think it's really important. Your concern is my concern. I'm working as hard as I can to come up with something that people can't get out of, that's going to be a viral idea that's going to make it unavoidable for our species to become not selfish. I mean, radically not selfish. It's that important to me. But what you're asking, where do you draw the line? Worse than that, I can say, what's the basis for drawing any line? And my point was, throw one out and let's see if it holds water or if we can take his pants down. Because all the ones I've heard so far, you can just take their pants down. It's just a matter of, that's my culture or that's my opinion, and you should have to live by my culture, my opinion, or my religion, right?
So
my values.
Once again, like, I'm not saying it's bad to have, you know, nice things or access to, you know, a good education or a nice culture.
But how nice? How about the dude in the clickbait thing? Is that nice? Or is he extravagant?
I mean, it seems almost obvious.
Should you have $100 billion in the bank and have a pilot on standby for your own 747 while other people don't have a sandwich to give to their kid? Is it wrong?
In my estimation, at the expense of suffering humanity, that is wrong.
Is it at the expense of suffering humanity?
When you can help them with what you've been blessed with.
So if you sold it all, you would help some of them, but the vast majority of them, like almost all of them, would still be pretty close to where they are at $100 billion. That wouldn't fix it. Sure.
And to, like,
Jesus spent the last 3 years of his life homeless. And he owned his robe. Right. You could go and do no good for anybody.
Yeah.
Or you could make billions and then give the billions away. Although, how many people did you hurt making the billions?
But I'm saying it's kind of like a part, like, I don't think there's a defined.
There's not.
It's just how you need to live, because who is it helping?
See, here's what I would like to give to a philosophy class. Not the answer, because there isn't a the answer. Rather, I like to give the best tools available to keep trying to take it apart and figure it out so that you never stop evaluating it and researching it and talking about it. Inside talking about it and outside talking about it. The idea is not to give you, okay, well, since we know, and there is research, it's about 5 years old right now, though. The research says that if you, and it's probably should be adjusted to say $90,000, but $70,000 for your income, if you have that, you can't increase your happiness at all by having any more than that per year. 70,000. Now, that's what the research came up with. It was in 2012, I think, the research said $70,000 in today in the United States. And adjusted to the local cost of living, it would apply anywhere in the world. Having more than that, having 80, you would not be happier than if you had 70. You won't be less happy either, but you won't be happier. Having 200,000, happier. But if you have 60, then you're not as happy as you could be if you had 70. That was the basis for that firm in the North Pacific, that loan processing or credit card processing company where the CEO decided that the minimum wage in his corporation was $70,000. So the receptionist, the janitor, the file clerks, whatever, the data entry people on the phone, all at least $70,000. If you Google that, if you just Google the CEO that that made $70,000 in the minimum wage, you will find that people, they gave him death threats. They're so angry with him. He's threatening America. He's a communist. He's a terrorist. He should, you know, we should
take his company away from him. He's dangerous. They can't stand it. And I know some of the people that are really against it. They posted it and called him profane names on Facebook. And some of them I know, they don't have enough to pay their bills. They're living on $30,000 or $40,000 a year, and they can't even pay off their student loans. So they're so mad, though, that he would do that. It's just so wrong. It's so libtard, you know. People can't stand the fact that his company is doing very much better. And by the way, he sold his mansion and his fancy cars, put himself on $70,000, and financed it with his more than $1 million salary to make it actually happen.
You just mentioned it. I was going to say, yeah, I just looked at an article about it. It's so interesting. He cut his own salary from $1 million to $70,000.
Yeah.
Matching that with the minimum wage.
Yes, he did. And then he lived in an apartment with a roommate so he could walk to work instead of living to some fancy place. And I mean, with that kind of salary, you could have a helicopter right to the roof. So, I mean, and it makes people mad, and he's still doing it. I don't know why it bothers. Well, I do. It threatens the illusion that it has to be that way to have a successful company. It's a crock of crap. And people are so committed to selfishness as a way of life that it offends them religiously when somebody would just, his own company, it bothers them. And it's kind of like when someone wants to go give sandwiches out to the homeless downtown. And then someone calls, so we're going to find a way to make them stop giving these people food. They do. They have meetings in the city council. They have people come testify about what's wrong with giving these people food when they're laying there crazy and mentally deficient and burned out and abused. And all they're doing is trying to give them a sandwich or a cup of soup or something. And it's like, get a law. Have it. Because it is threatening their not very effective, but still functional means of having a little bit of pleasure in this life, which is from shot avoidance, which is, I am using such poor strategies to have a good time that the best time I have is when I see you screwed up. A social relationship is one in which people interact and it affects each person to some degree. Let's see. If I can benefit me, hurt you. So I help me, I hurt you. That's selfishness, okay? If we both get something out of our exchange or our interface, then that's mutual benefit. If it goofs me but it helps you, then that's altruism or altruistic. And if it's like, I don't care if it screws me over, I'm gonna hurt you. That's spite. Now this is what one theorist has put together to describe these exchanges. What my area right now is to look at the neuropsychology of what goes on, what parts of the brain are being activated, what's the endocrinology that corresponds to that, and is it something we could modify? Do we modify people's brain functions because
the way it's functioning is not working for them in society. You ever heard of Prozac or Adderall? We use pills to like make it so that receptor sites or a proportion of them or some of them for a certain neurotransmitter are not available for that neurotransmitter anymore because we blocked it with something that is ineffective but still holds on to the site in the synapse. But it won't, the real deal won't get there. It'll hold on, but it won't give the message for the neuron to fire. So we do that with designer drugs. What if we had a designer drug that would simply mean that we're not driven for that. We don't get it. That doesn't get it for us. Well, what good does that ever do anybody? You've seen people act like that. You and I have acted like that. It's like, I don't care if it kills me. I'm going to hurt you. People do that, don't they? You do that, don't you? Sometimes. Come on. So, why is this sanity? Why do we decide, why do we, when we take the vote for what's sane and insane, is this not insane? That's just cultural. I think it's insane, and it ought to be fixed. Do you? So that's, I mean, I'm on it, man. And I'm going to be trying to get an army of people on it with me. Because why not? Why are we okay with this? And why are we okay with that? Because it turns out this looks like it'll make people happy, but it actually doesn't. And there's solid research to prove that. Solid research. This doesn't make anyone happy. Some people die for that. They go in and they off everybody that's torque them, and then they off themselves before the cops come. I don't think that's getting them anywhere. It's not helping. I can't imagine that that's helpful. So, anyway, back to the fish. It turns out, oh, and you guys might want to look up the quantum Zeno effect if you want to not be able to sleep tonight, because that's a real-life physics horror. It's actually true that if you look at something that's a quantum process and you keep observing it the way that it is, it actually has sort of a statistically measurable impact that sort of locks it into the space that it's on. And if you do something very similar to the kind of conditioning you do when you train an intelligent creature that's trainable, like a dog or a person, whatever, where you vary the reward, and you go away from it for a little while, but you come back and you look at it some more, and you go, you can actually kind of make it like an immune system to ever decaying, which is just bizarre. So look up the quantum Zeno effect, it's woo-woo. And here's a weird thing about what our mind does too. We know, of course, that the mind can lock in, that our measurement and awareness of the measurement can lock in whether a photon is a particle or a wave. On that? Yes? Now I've told you about the quantum Zeno effect. Did any of you already know about the quantum Zeno effect? Anyone here already know about quantum Zeno effect? Good. You want to wiki that? That'd be kind of fun. Turns out when you get enough people together, and we did get a little bit further than this last time, you get enough people, you take them one at a time, you have them, say, watching for an hour each, the Geiger counter, they're listening to the clicks. And this is clicks that on the average, we'll say click 30 times a minute, you know, whatever, that's arbitrary, I don't remember what the exact figures were. But this is the point. And you tell half of those people, divide them into thirds, and have one third of them just sit there and listen to the thing and nothing else. Then you have another third and you tell them to use their mind to try, whatever that means to them, to try to hear, to make it with their mind so that there's less clicks. To try to have it click less times. And then the last third, you tell them to try concentrating, like as to pretend even that they can make it click more times. And here's the weird part. The group that was trying to make it click more times, it clicked more times. And the group that they were trying to get to click less times, pretending that they had some special superpower, it clicked less times. And the group that was told to just sit there and listen, pay attention, but they weren't told to try anything, it averaged the 30 times a minute. It averaged just like if they weren't there. Okay? Yes? I know, we're getting there. So this is where it gets even weirder. Remember, I hope it's not obscene. Oh, good, it's empty. Okay. Remember the timeline? We were talking about the timeline? And I told you, it appears there might be some of that going on. Remember? That you might be able to have an impact back there. So instead of letting the people listen to the clicks, when the clicks are made, they have the computer record the sound, but no people heard the sound. Okay? Same number of times as what I described to you. Then, you take all of the representations that they have that the computer, but you put them on thumb drives, you store them in vaults that people can't get to. They're Faraday cages in vaults in several places in the country. And then you wait 6 months. 6 months later, nobody has heard that. No human mind has any idea the rate at which those things decay. No human nervous system has had any way to register the signal when the thing occurred. And now, you play it back as if you had the Geiger counter right there and the radioactive sample, but you don't, because that was 6 months ago. And you have the people pretend, while they're listening to the recording of that they have a special superpower, and they pretend that they can make it. One third is trying everything they can to make less clicks, and the other third is trying to make more clicks, and the last group is simply told to just listen. And guess what? The same thing as when they're hearing it live. And then you check it against the other copies that were stored in other countries and all that and listen to it. And the human mind appears to have subtly impacted, not one for one, but it's just very slight probabilistic, but enough to be statistically relevant and significant. It affected something that happened 6 months ago when it was actually getting recorded. Now, here's how we can test and see if that's actually happening. Okay? What I just said, got it?
do it again. The whole thing I just said, you do it again. Only you have twice as many people. So you make some of the samples on the memory stick. Like you duplicate it. In other words, instead of three groups, you have six groups of data from those three people. Each person makes twice as much. Then you, 6 months later, you pull the thing out, and each person's recorded part, you just take half of it, and you have a person just listen to it. That's all. They just listen to it. Only half of it. So each of the three groups, half of their data gets listened to by a human being. They hear it, but not the other. Then you have the people do the thing with their mind where they try to make it. It turns out that the samples that were not listened to, they could modify them back in the past, but not the ones that were listened to. About that? It happened. Because when human consciousness heard it, it locked it in. It locked it in the past, before these people could. Now that a person's heard it, the next person cannot impact it with their mind. Just like with the photon, once someone has detected it as one thing, they can't detect it later. Another person can't detect it later as the other function. So they collapsed the wave function when they played half of each of those datums to a person who's just listening to it, not trying anything. Now, the fish. What would happen instead of having a human listen to it, to corrupt half of it, to lock in half of it? What would happen if you took another living creature that's not even human, and they chose a fish? And what they did, each time it went click, they just made a mild electric current go through the water. Not enough to electrocute the fish, or even cause the fish pain. Just enough to be noticeable. So it's like, what the heck was that? You're not going to, you just take the 9-volt battery, the little rectangular one, and touch your tongue with this. This doesn't really hurt that bad. It's like, oh, get off my tongue. Like that, only even a little less. Just enough to notice. If you're checking the battery in the smoke detector, and you put it on your tongue, and it's pretty dead, it's almost dead, and you know you need to change it, but it's sort of like, if you feel a little something, but it's not enough to go, oh, geez. You know what I mean? Like that for the fish in the water. Turns out, when they did that using the fish and having that signal, so the fish became aware of the pattern without even any understanding, that was enough to collapse the alternate wave functions, just like when a human being listened audibly to the Geiger counter. There's the fish. Is that weird enough? That's it. Pretty normal. I mean, I do that stuff all the time, don't you? I do that. But the weird thing is, you've got 6 months going by, and somebody affects something that was recorded. Well, they don't affect the thing. They affect the process 6 months ago when it was being recorded, collapsing the alternate wave function. Now, that should not be that big of a surprise. It's just a surprise that we find a way to detect something that weird. But we know that quantum mechanics has to involve other dimensions. In quantum mechanics, things can be here, and zero time goes by, and they're here now. Or in quantum mechanics, we can make an object superposition so that you're seeing the object, not half of it, you're full on seeing the object here and here at the same time. And then make it stop, and it's just here where it belongs. But you can make it appear, make it be two places at once. And you can do that not with microscopes and gold foil. You can do that with objects big enough for you to see. You can go on YouTube and find superposition experiments where macro scale objects are in two places at once. that really can be done. So it's just quantum mechanics. But it's just another check-in with whether or not our four dimensions are the whole thing. And they're not. We're on the chalkboard, only it seems like, to us, it seems like all there is. But try right now to imagine the fifth dimension. Which direction would you go? You can't go this way, that one's taken. You can't go this way, that one's taken. That would be a little y. X, y. You can't go this way, that's taken. That's a z. And you can't use time. That one's already busy too. Now picture the fifth one. And then remember what it's like try to picture us not being flat. Does that make any sense? Mathematically, we can generate what it would look like if a shadow should fall on our four dimensions of a five-dimensional object. We can model the shadow. Now think about the nature of shadows. If I want to cast a shadow on Stick Guy's world, what I can do, I have all the dimensions except in and out. I have up and down, left and right, and time right now. But we're lacking the depth. See, the shadow has it's just lacking one, right? So if you had a five-dimensional object, the shadow could be something that looks to us like a three-dimensional object, but it breaks the rules of the way they're supposed to move and be. And it turns out we can generate these things. They're called tesseracts. Tesseract. You go on YouTube and look at a tesseract on YouTube, you will see a five-dimensional. No, what you see is a representation that's, since you're not seeing it in three dimensions, you're seeing it flat, but we're pretending with the way you do, you know, the way, like if we take a video of us here, and then you look at it on the video screen, we pretend we've got that other, we use other cues instead of actual depth. But what happens is you have an object that violates certain things, like it can be here, and then it can be over here without being having to travel across, and with zero time going by, or can be in more than one place at the same time, and confuse the concepts of subset and superset. A part of it can geometrically demonstrate that a part of it is actually a whole that it's only a part of. And the logic gets really fuzzy. When you watch them, you can watch it. And this right here, this is called a Klein bottle. A Klein bottle it has depth, unlike watching a moving tesseract on the screen on YouTube, which you can do. You can look up tesseract on YouTube. But this, instead of moving, it's like taking a snapshot of it, but it's actually in 3D, because it's a mechanical object. It has depth. Whereas on the screen, it has no depth, but it has time. It moves. This doesn't move. This holds still. This is just what it would look like if a tesseract was actually appearing, like a hologram was here, it would look like this. But you have to picture that if it was moving, this thing that comes sticking out of it wouldn't be stuck there. That thing could move through its own surface. And this opening here could become the whole thing. It keeps morphing and morphing. But if you picture yourself being an ant on this actually doesn't have an inside and an outside. It's actually one-sided. It's a one-sided object. If you crawl, you'll realize that your outside became your inside without knowing. Yes, that's correct. How many of you do not know what he just said?
I didn't hear it.
He said, so is that just a three-dimensional version of a Mobius strip? How many of you do not know what that means? Let's break out the paper and the tape. Adding machine paper. Supply everybody with about 2 feet of adding machine paper, and they can help you because there's scissors there for everyone, there's tape. Pass that all out. While he's passing it, I'll give you another concept. Enough fish for now. We'll come right back to that. This is really just sort of dovetailing things, kind of funny, but while he's passing that around, you're going to want a piece about, 2 feet is enough, or less, like 18 inches. Oh, you're right, I didn't pay him, did I? While he's doing that, I want to divide history into philosophical eras. So will the exam and the next quiz. And the midterm, that kind of thing. That's not a good color. Should have about 18 inches or 2 feet or whatever. Do you? And you need a piece of tape, just one, inch and a half or so. All right. And while you're doing that, three major eras in philosophy, Western philosophy. You want to know these. You definitely want to know these. The axial model was the mindset that came about sometime, or it was under development and finding its way into being the way that people in the West kind of all thought over about a 600-year period. It was coming about. It's like its birth date. It was like 800 BCE to 200 BCE. It took about 600 years to fully develop and become what people were all kind of reading off that page. And it persisted, actually, all the way to sometime in the 18th century CE. Okay? The axial model is such that the life we're in right now is a throwdown life. You know what I mean by throwdown? Yeah, this isn't it. This is just sort of like the intro part of the movie that you don't want to hear, and it's sort of like the part where they have some stupid cartoon to tell you to shut your cell phone off before the movie starts and bothers people in the theater. You always think you're getting something, and you kind of get into it, and you go, oh, a cartoon or whatever, and then you go, oh, it's just them bossing me up about my phone. It's not even the movie. So they kind of thought that what we're in right now is that. This isn't even really the movie. This is just a big up yours. This is a throwdown. This is like go to the bathroom during this time so you don't have to during the good part of the movie. Later on, there's going to be something that's payday, baby. Later on, we get to the good stuff. at the end of this life, or at the end of this era, they had different ways of looking at it, but the thing that they all in Western thought had in common during the Axial era was that there was this notion that this is less real, and the real good stuff, the stuff that's actually more, that counts, that's valid, that puts this to shame, that matters, is coming later, after some transition. Now, that persists in Adventist thought, does it not? This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. Yes? I've got a mansion just over the hilltop, you know, with a harp and a crown, yada yada. When Jesus comes back, then it starts to count. But this, the only thing that matters here is to make it so that I get there. Whatever I have to do so I don't screw up getting there, that's all that matters. So this is throwdown. That's an axial model. Western thought transitioned from that. Even Adventists today, however, even though they have that idea that Jesus is coming, is there anybody here that would say you don't also have in your mind somewhere a sort of, yeah, but then I think about it in other terms? You have another way to think about it, kind of like when you're with your friends that aren't Adventists, and you're talking to them in the neighborhood, and you're not in a mood to preach. So now you're engaging in this discussion that's almost as if that's not it. No, not everybody. Some people, it's their whole operating system. They've never watched a movie. They've never watched TV. Their parents were careful to keep them away from bad influence, people who saw something at all different. And so it is your absolute, you don't have any, you know, there's not two ways to even think about it. In any event, that's the axial model. Now, during the axial era, at least, the first parts of the earliest parts of the axial era, during the BCE part, people were concerned about death. Death was a major concern for people back then. And trying to figure out what to do with it, how to relate to it, what's it mean, what happens after we die, yada yada. In the 18th century, you know, 1700s, what we think of as the Enlightenment, the British Enlightenment, whatever, the Western Enlightenment, the Enlightenment period, where people transition to starting to deem as more important reason and man's reason and progress that we could achieve through our reason. Does everyone have that stuff now? Okay, hold it like this, so it doesn't have a twist in it. Just hold it like this, all right? Now, you're going to bring the ends together, but you're going to just, one of them, you're just going to turn over just 180 degrees, just like that. Not a full 360, just going to, instead of having a perfect loop like that, you're just going to turn one of them like that. That's all. Not completely around, just like that. Fair enough? Everybody have that? Yes, you have a crown. We'll make harps. Now that you've done that, what I want you to do is take your writing implement, your pen or pencil. Pen is probably better. Is everybody taped up? Everybody's taped up? We'll get to it Tuesday. I want you to just take your writing instrument. You have tape? Everyone taped up? If you're not ready, tell me. You're ready? You're so ready. Okay. Take your writing implement. I want you to put it right in the middle, but don't lift it up. You need to keep it in contact with the paper, all right? And then you're going to draw on it a line that just runs the length of it like this. I only want you to do one side. So go until you catch the line that you started, the mark where you started. Just keep drawing. Do not draw on the other side. Please draw only on one side. All right? We need the other side undrawn on, so don't lift it up. Do not lift it up. Okay? Okay, draw that out. I got mine done. As soon as you come back and meet yourself where you started, then please don't draw on the other side, though. One side only.
I know. I already did.
There we go. So you got only one side drawn on? Yes? Please tell me now how many sides this has. It's a sheet of paper with only one side. What's the front and the back? That's an absurd question. That's an absurd question. Just as absurd as asking what is past and future. Just as absurd as asking what's the past and what's the future. Okay? This is called a Mobius strip, and it is, people of course can say it's only a model of a one-sided object because it actually, you know, it's actually a three-sided object because the paper has a side. So it's an imaginary object, and this is a model of it. Okay? Just like this is just a model of a tesseract in this Klein model. Okay? This is actually called a question mark Klein model, shaped like a question mark. Literally, reminiscent of Roadrunner days, I bought this from the Acme Klein Bottle Company. It really is from the Acme Klein Bottle Company in Berkeley. Yes.
So have you ever put water in that?
I haven't. I'm afraid I wouldn't be able to access it to get the mineral deposits off of it. It wouldn't be as dazzling if I couldn't clean it out. I could put distilled water in it, I suppose, but even that is likely to gather some dust or something and then dry on it. I couldn't get a towel. Yeah, you put it in here, and it would go down here, and then it would be in there. But the thing is, when you imagine that this right here, where it seems to be stuck in here, and this seems to be stuck here, actually with a tesseract, it's not stuck. This is a dynamic process. And the parts that you see that look like they're inside sort of, this thing keeps opening, keeps like coming open on itself like this, keeps morphing. So what's up in here, like inside this little arch, would as this blossoms open, this what's there would end up here and would end up on the outside of itself as it continued to move, because it's an in-motion object. That's the dimension that, because it's a snapshot, you can't see. But you can see tesseracts behaving in those kinds of ways, the logic of their behavior, if you look at a YouTube video of tesseracts. There's hundreds of them. I don't know if there's hundreds. I sound like I'm running for president now. There's more than one. It'll be, if you watch it, it'll be the most fantastic ever. So, we experience our timeline of like an ant that would be crawling on this with no awareness that it's able to come back and meet itself, perhaps, or that it's an absurdity what is. Well, and also keep in mind that in the dynamic space-time plus one dimension continuum, you'd also have things that were like this, where you put the line to touch the line, and where the line was actually a synonym at that point, a word. And so then you could go from here to there, and all we're experiencing would be someone that went from here to either side of this at will, like a miracle. Like when we play around with this, hacking the ability to collapse the alternate wave function of the Geiger counters measured clicks, because that's from a quantum process that we detected the pattern of. We don't even have to understand it. We don't even have to have a word for it. We could be a fish, and our consciousness is adequate. What is consciousness? That it's capable of drawing things from more dimensions and locking them into this dimension. Don't know, but it's something. Imagine that if time to us, if we were in five dimensions, imagine that if time to us was like geography to us. My daughter lives in North Carolina, and I don't get to see her about once every year or two. She's not here. Now, if I didn't have an airplane, let's say it was North Carolina and I was here, but it was 200 years ago. I might never see her again. But somebody from this time period could say, just get on a jet. Yeah. No, not 200 years ago or 300 years ago. How about 300 years ago? Somebody's in Montana and somebody else is in Florida. Your kids are gone. So, yes, we have devices to go from here to the East Coast. Somebody in five dimensions, it's just a matter of, you know, wherever they want to go. So if you live for a certain period, that would be like your geography. My daughter is not at the same time that she's in Wilmington, North Carolina. She's not also in Bangor, Maine. She's there. She goes back and forth in that part. She goes back and forth to where she works like an hour and a half away. And back home, but she doesn't usually go to Bangor, Maine. If you go find her, you're not going to be able to look over there, but you have to go where she is. So you go where the person, to their temporal address. A day is like a, what? Yes, it is. And the fact that it's confusing and that we cannot wrap our minds around it, but we know that it is necessarily true, is another enormous reason to really consider how stupid it is to be arrogant instead of humble. It should make us humble. We don't get the joke. And we know we. You ever hear people that are just vastly more intelligent than you that tell a joke and laugh their heads off, and then you go, and then kind of laugh to be polite. And you go, I'm too stupid to get that. Yeah, I've had that happen when I go to my residential conferences and I'm sitting with people who've got more digits in their IQ than most people. You know, their IQ is more like my weight. And I'll be sitting at the table with a whole group of professors there. And these are guys, you know, they're up in their 70s and 80s. And they actually, every year that goes by, it's exponential how fast they learn and the things they come up with. So it wouldn't matter what IQ I started with. If I'm not up in their age category, I couldn't have possibly gotten to where they're there. They say something and I'm going, I don't know what they said. And they choking on their food is so funny. We don't get the joke. When God is asked, well, what's your name? I've got to tell the king what your name is. Rolling of God's eyes. You're asking for my name. That's what you move. Can I just use it? Are you on Twitter, man? What is it? You linked that? I think you up on Facebook. name, so you can look me up in the God phone book.
What's the matter with you?
Don't Google me. I am the always having been will be. I'm, you don't even get existence enough to get that I am existence, that I author existence. A day, 1,000 years, no, same bit to me, I don't care. 1,000 years, like a day, whatever. I can go back and forth in either one of them. So, keep that thought. Don't forget what we said about that. You want to take a picture of it. Me too, because I got to remember where I was.
I like never.